Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Dennis Chookaszian and Jeremy Slate here. Dennis is the retired chairman and CEO of CNA Insurance Companies, and Jeremy is the CEO and co-founder of Command Your Brand Media. So we are going to talk about boards, podcasts, having a meaningful life, and having a great career. So stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Dennis Chookaszian, who is a retired chairman and chief executive officer of CNA Insurance Companies. During his career, he served as director on the boards of 13 publicly traded corporations and 50 private corporations. If I read your bio, I think we'd be here all day, so I think I want to get in to just welcoming you to the show, Dennis. You've done so many interesting things, from being a trustee at Northwestern University to a member of the National Board of Boy Scouts of America. You've really had an impressive background, and I can't wait to chat. So welcome to the show.
Well, thanks, Diane. It's a pleasure to meet you.
Well, it's a pleasure for me as well. And we chatted a little before the show about all the different things that you are working on right now, and I just think that there's just so many different ways that we can go, and I want to talk a little bit about, I know you teach, and I think it's really interesting to look at some of the work that you're working on to develop a successful life. And you and I both do have our own systems. Mine was how to, you know, what inhibits curiosity and determining those factors. But you have something you've worked on, and I want to get into that. But before we do, I would like to get a little more of a background on you. I gave a highlights of your, you know, where you ended up and where you, you know, what you, some of the boards and things that you've done. But can you give us a little background story on you? What led to that success?
Sure. I'd be happy to, Diane. And that also factors into the two courses I teach at the University of Chicago. The course is called Corporate Governance, but then part of the course is called Personal Governance, where I talk about ways to build a successful life. And so, quick background on myself, I have a very technical background. I was a chemical engineer at Northwestern, an MBA at University of Chicago, Master's in Economics, London School of Economics. So I'm a CPA, so I've got a very technical background in both computer systems and finance. And my career was built on that. And I was in consulting for 8 years before I joined CNA. I was with CNA for 27 years, and I was the president, chairman, and CEO. I was chief financial officer for 15 years, and then president, chairman, and CEO. And then after I retired, I started doing what I'm doing now, which is serving on boards and doing a lot of private business things, and I'm still very active. And so a couple of quick things. We all have our own personal philosophies, but the one that drives me and the one that you suggested is something which I teach in my class that I call pick two. And pick two is that there are three things in everyone's life. You have your work life, you have your family life, and you have your personal life. Your personal life is defined as those things that are of interest to you that are not being done with your family. And so when I say pick two, the answer is there are not enough hours in the day to do all three successfully, so you have to pick two. And in my case, I have a lot of really strong outside interests that I had when I was younger, but I knew I could not have a successful both family life and work life if I did them, so I fundamentally gave them up. And those are things which I don't do. So the only things I do now are either, and it's been true really since I started working, are either things that I'm working on or I'm doing with my family. Now, the one way to make that a little easier is to try to convince your family to do things that are personal ideas for you that you like. Uh-huh. And then you can sort of blend the two, but it's really a family activity. And so in my case, one of those is skiing. Uh-huh. And another one is golf. So with my children. You know, I taught them all to ski and play golf when they were younger, and so now we do a lot of skiing and play golf together. So that's sort of a little bit of a blend. But that's a way of trying to get a little bit of the balance in your life. The other element of it is how to be successful in life. And in being successful in life, I have a little model that I say that there are three keys to success. And these three keys to success on the business side of what you do are, first, you need a technical competency. Second, you need a specific attitude that I'll describe. And finally, third, you need networking. So okay. If you're going to be successful in a business career, it's one thing you have to realize, and particularly today, is there's so many intelligent people out there, so many people around you that have the kind of training and education that you have. You have to find a way to stand out. And so everyone needs, first, before they do anything else, some technical competency. Now, the competency could be something like skill in computer programming or financial analysis, or it could be a softer skill, like ability to deal with people. It could be a negotiating skill. You have to have something that causes you to stand out, to cause you to be identified.
Right.
It's not a lot different than in sports. If you play basketball or any sport that you play, there's going to be something about your athletic performance where people are going to notice that, and it's going to cause them to remember you. Like, you mm-hmm. can dunk the basketball, or you've got an amazing tennis forehand, or whatever. You've got something that causes you to stand out above the crowd. Because if you don't have that, you look like everybody else, and you never get noticed. Now, it doesn't matter what it is, but you have to find some technical
competency. Does it have to be positive? I mean, can you have Charles Barkley's golf swing?
No, that would be, well, you can, but that is not going to be good.
Okay.
Yeah, so, yeah, because you're going to be under, because nobody is going to say to you, hey, great, this guy's, not going to think positively
just
about
easy.
Someone.
Okay.
So it's got to be something that stands out on the positive side that people say, wow, that shows accomplishment. And so that gives them the willingness to move you along rather than someone else. So number one is that. The second element of it is attitude, where in terms of attitude, there are, and we all know that, you know, you deal with people every day. There's some people in the morning, you get up, you're going to go to deal with somebody, and sometimes there's some people you just dread going and meeting with certain people.
Yeah.
And other people you really look forward to meeting with.
Right.
And so you want to be the person who has that positive attitude that everyone looks forward to meeting with and is always the person that is doing things for others. And so how do you do that? Well, you have a thing I call the marble theory. The marble theory says that you go to a new job, and the first day on the job, they tell you, okay, here's your job, here's where you're going to sit, and they tell you all the things about it, and then they give you, figuratively, a bag of marbles. And you say, well, what's this? Well, that bag of marbles is your score system. And you start with a certain number of marbles in the bag. From that time on, you're adding marbles or you're deleting marbles from the bag. And when you run out of marbles, you're fired. Doesn't matter how smart you are. How do you end up with marbles being added or deleted from the bag? Well, the way you add marbles to the bag is you're nice to the administrative people. You always show up early. If there's a conference call, you're always on the call 3 or 4 minutes before everyone else, so nobody's waiting for you.
Right.
You're always volunteering to do something. If someone comes into your office, you offer them a cup of coffee. There are all these things that you do that are the niceties or the civilities and the way of dealing with people the way you'd like to be dealt with. And so those things add marbles to your... What deletes marbles from your bag are the opposites,
mm-hmm.
when you do things that are just the opposite of that. And so the person who is going to be successful is the person with a lot of marbles in the bag. Because if you get to a point where there's going to be a choice between two people and they're equally competent, the one with more marbles is going to win. So that's a very important factor. Now, if you do those first two things, technical competency and attitude, it's the third thing that's the critical factor. That's networking, because you can't put your light under a bushel. So what you have to do in any circumstance, you have to be always thinking about how you promote yourself from a networking point of view, and not in an offensive way, of course.
Right.
But what you want to do is you want to find, how do you take advantage of every opportunity that you have to get your word out there, get your name out there? The reason that I've been on so many boards, I've actually served on now, including all the not-for-profit boards, I've been on 13 public company boards, and I've actually been on 70 private company boards and 20 not-for-profits. So I've been on 100 boards. And the reason for that is that I'm constantly letting people know I'd like to do that, and that they see what I've done in other places. If my attitude is a positive one and they like me, then I get selected to be on those boards.
Right.
So I'm always networking, and so that's a critical factor. So the key to success is those three things. Find your technical competency, have an attitude that makes you a person everybody wants to be with, and finally network, network, network. And so if you do those things, you will have a successful career.
You know, those are all really great tips. But as you're talking about being on boards, I've had a lot of people on the show talk about women on boards and how do you become a board of directors. And I serve on a lot of board of advisors committees, and I've talked to a lot of people about this. And I know they're trying to get more women on boards. California had their law and all the things that they've put into effect. But, you know, a lot of times I agree the networking is super critical, but how do we get women or others on boards if they haven't been CEOs in the past or C-suite necessarily, but we're trying to get more diverse boards? I was just curious what you think on that.
Sure, yeah. And it's the issue of diversity on boards, and it's not just women, it's also racial diversity.
Mm-hmm.
And what you really want, and so why do you want diversity? What you want is you want diversity of thought.
Right.
So you want people who come from a different background. If everybody comes from the same background, you don't need a board, you need one person, because that person has the background.
Uh-huh.
So you want these diverse thoughts. And I will tell you from all of my experience, having served on now like 100 boards, I will tell you that there is absolutely, factually, I can point to case after case where women bring a different perspective than men. Not every time, of course, but women bring a different perspective that's exceedingly valuable in a board situation. Someone who grows up with a different racial identity than the norm in this country is also going to bring a perspective that's exceedingly valuable in this decision making. Now, it's going to be different, of course, in different elements of it, but there's no question that that brings a lot of value. So it's a critical factor. That's something I identified when I was at the very early part of my career as something that needed to happen. And when I went to work for CNA, mm-hmm. the company that I eventually became the CEO of, I went in as the chief financial officer in 1975, and at that time we had 100 officers in the company, and there was only one woman. Now this is the insurance industry, which was white male. That's the way it was structured. We had one woman, and we had at that time we had no African Americans, and we had and at that time there were very few Hispanics and people of Asian descent as well. In the company, it just wasn't there. It was basically a white male organization at the top. Now, when you went down the organization was more than half female, because females did the work in the company and they had good jobs, but they weren't in the senior management ranks.
Right.
So I made it a goal to try to change that. And by the time I left CNA, 25 years later, 50% of our officers were women.
Wow.
I was the CEO, and I had three major people reporting to me that ran the businesses. Two of them were women, one was a man. Our African-American count moved up to 8%, which is still lower than where I wanted it to be in the officer group.
Mm-hmm.
But it was an improvement, but it wasn't as strong as I wanted to be. But we did make our goal of 50% women in the officer group. So it was something you can do something about. Now, the boards that I serve on, and depending on whose numbers you want to believe, but the number of women on public boards has hovered between 15 and 20% for the last 20 years.
Right.
In spite of people saying they want to increase women on boards. There's a reason for that, and there is also a solution to it.
Okay.
The reason for it, and having served on so many board selection committees, here's how it works. And particularly today, after Sarbanes-Oxley, and let's take public companies. Private companies are a different story. Let's take public companies. In a public company setting, after Sarbanes-Oxley, it's no longer true that the way you get on the board is you play golf with the CEO.
Okay.
If you go back to 1990, I called boards of directors the old white boys club.
Right.
Because they were all old, they were all male, and they were all white.
Right.
And so how did you get on the board? You played golf with the CEO.
Right.
That's how you did it, because the CEO wanted somebody on the board that was going to support him. You wouldn't put somebody who was going to be your antagonist on the board.
Right.
Now, when Sarbanes-Oxley occurred back in 2002, by law, you are required to now have consideration of the board membership done through a nominating and governance committee, and the CEO's influence was substantially diminished. And it didn't happen on one day. It happened as it evolved, but as it evolved into today, the CEO no longer selects the board members. It has an influence, but no longer selects them. So what happens? What you do is you say, and more than likely today, in a board situation, you'll say to yourself, we're going to bring someone in. What are the characteristics? First, you list the characteristics you want for a board member. What's on top of most boards' list? Former CEO.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, and so what else is on the list? Well, it might be financial skill. It might be technical skill. It might be industry, regulatory, marketing, the internet, something like that. There are other skills.
Right.
You list them. And then also on the list is diversity.
Right.
Now, when you look at that, you're going to give that list to the recruiting firms. And usually the way you get candidates today, there are four major firms that do most of the board search. And then there are others that support it as well. But those four are the dominant ones. I know them well. If you give them a list of candidates, they're going to come back to you, or a list of qualifications, they'll come back to you with 10 candidates. What are you going to get? You're going to get 8 white men. You're going to get 1 African-American and 1 woman. That's what you're going to get. Now, when you select from them, they'll all be equally qualified, and some more than other. What's the probability that you're going to select the woman or the African-American person? It's going to be, you know, they're 1 in 10, so maybe they get selected a little more than that.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe they're selected 15% of the time.
Right.
And when you do that, what happens? You never change the composition. It stays where it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So there is, and the reason for that, it's not that there is a, some people say, oh, there are not enough qualified women or African Americans. That's complete nonsense, total nonsense.
Right.
I have been on board after board, and I have no problem finding qualified women, qualified minorities, not just African Americans, also Hispanic, Asian. You have no problem finding qualified minorities or women. However, the problem is there's way more men who are white men. And you know, the just the supply of white men is so large compared to the supply of minorities and women for that position, because women hadn't risen yet through the ranks of the vice president level and so forth to fit that qualification level. So when they search, they do find more white men than women or minorities. So you get the wrong balance.
Right.
So what I say to my boards when I'm on the board, they develop the criteria, I say, take diversity off the list. It's not an objective. And they'll say, no, diversity is very important. We want it on the list. I said, no, it's not. Because if it was important to you, you would take everything else off the list and have only diversity. And they say, what do you mean? I say, well, when we go to the recruiting firm, tell them, do not give us a candidate unless they're diverse. I want to get a list of 10 diverse candidates, women and minorities. And if you give me a white man, he's not going to be selected for the board. So don't give me a list with a white man.
Yeah.
And if you don't do that, you will never change the composition. It'll stay at 15%. So you have to decide what's your objective. Because if you ask for a broad list and say best athlete, you're never going to get a change in the composition of the board. It just won't happen. That's why it stayed where it is.
Well,
so on the boards that I've done this, I say this very forcefully, I've gotten a number of my boards to be able to do that and take action, and we've really made a change in the composition percentage on those boards by doing that. But the way we did it is by saying we're going to only bring on a diverse candidate.
But how about diversity of knowledge? I mean, I hear a lot of so much focus on CFOs and maybe technology people, but what about cultural experts? What about people who are HR experts? Do you ever look at how some of, I mean, if we know everybody's hired for their knowledge and fired for their behaviors, pretty much, we aren't really focusing on behaviors if that's where everybody's losing money, you know, with the Gallup poll showing $500 billion a year loss and engagement and all that. Are board members talking about those issues, and do you need cultural experts on the board?
Yeah, it's interesting. I've had this discussion many times.
Uh-huh.
And first, you have to break your question down into two parts. First,
okay.
Is culture important, and does that make a difference in the success of the company? And my answer to that is absolutely yes.
Right.
It's critical. So that it's something that you must attempt to develop the right culture. And it starts with tone at the top. It starts with the board,
right.
Then the CEO, and that's critical. Now, the question is, do you need experts in that at the board level? And I'd argue that the answer to that is no, because that the board can only do one thing, which is to set the tone at the top and set the structure. Uh-huh. It's the management team that has to implement the culture, and you need your experts a level down. You don't need them at the board level. A board level knowing a lot about HR or whatever is of no value. What is he going to do at the board level? He never hires anybody. He never has any impact on it. And the reason for that is what my dictum is, which is how you run a board. The role of the board is very simple. It should be noses in, fingers out. And the fingers out part is the reason why you don't want some culture expert on the board, because they're not going to do anything with that knowledge. They can't. Mm-hmm. They go to a board meeting 5 or 6 times a year. Uh-huh. They're there for 3 or 4 hours. What are they going to do? What you want on the board is people who will have this noses in, know what's going on, set the tone for the company as a whole,
right,
and understand that you're going to set the right culture, the right ethical challenges, and you don't need to be an expert to do that. That's something that any CEO knows, any uh-huh. CFO knows,
right,
anyone who's a head of marketing. So you don't need that skill at the top level. That's already embedded in everybody that you bring onto the board, hopefully. So where you need that skill of how you build culture and programs is in the company reporting to the CEO.
Well,
that's where that role needs to exist.
Well, this is really interesting. And you teach some of this, some of the things we're talking about today in your courses you mentioned. And I was looking at your background and some of what you teach. Now, we talked a little bit before the show that you also focus on wealth and on life status. Is that something that's in your courses, or is that, I'm curious if you're speaking to groups outside of universities as a speaker often, or what your main focus is with your topic?
Yes, I do. Well, I teach at the 2 courses at the University of Chicago. Then I teach,
right,
or I have up until December of this year, I teach at 2 universities in China. So I'm in China, two or three times a year teaching at a Chinese university. And there I'm teaching CEOs of Chinese companies how to apply modern management techniques to Chinese companies. And then I also do a lot of public speaking. I probably do 20 or 30 speeches a year on various topics or seminars that I teach. So I do quite a bit of that. And I I have one element in my course at the University of Chicago. It's a 3-hour a week course, a 10-week course, 3 hours a week. And 2 hours and 45 minutes of each course is the corporate governance. It's how you run companies, Sarbanes-Oxley, legal standards, marketing, all of those issues.
Uh-huh.
The last 15 minutes of each class is called personal governance. It's how to lead your life. And one of them is the marble theory that I discussed. One of them is, pick two. So I've got a series of things. And one of them is relationships with your significant other. So I have a number of things like that, and I teach them in that element of the course.
Well, you know, when you talked about the marble theory, I was wondering if you thought that any of the marbles were subjective. Are those all?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay.
And it's going to be different in different places. So one example would be appearance. And I'll give you one that's very subjective.
Okay.
So in the U.S., for example, if you look at who is the senior leaders of companies and the senior presidents, as a general statement, senior leaders do not have facial hair.
Oh, yeah.
So if you look at presidents of the United States, in the 1800s, every president had big facial hair.
Right.
And then by the time you got to the 1900s, facial hair went out of style for the presidents. There hasn't been a president with a mustache or beard in the last 75 years or 100 years. The reason for that is it's not in style. It doesn't appear presidential. And as a consequence, it's not there. In the CEOs of companies, generally speaking, facial hair has not been one of the elements. So if you strive to do something, you want to try to consider what the world thinks of that. Because I don't really care at all about facial hair one way or the other.
Right.
It's the same thing for women. If you look at women in their dress, a woman has an ability to dress more modestly and more businesslike, or more like she's going to a party. If you look at the women who are in senior leadership roles, you never see them dressed in clothing that makes it look like they're going to a party or flamboyantly or in an immodest fashion.
Right.
Women who are in leadership roles understand that you need to dress for the part. So yes, is that a subjective thing? You bet. And the people in those positions are like that. So if you want to be one of those, why do you want to try to be something different? Because you're going to stand out in the wrong way.
You know, you bring up an interesting point, because my next book that's coming out soon is about perception in the workplace and how every culture looks at things in different ways, and how it's, you know, a lot of this is some of the stuff we talk about. But, you know, as a woman speaker, it's so challenging to get up on stage and not have somebody analyze what we wear so much more than the men, you know, from,
yes.
I mean, even if it, yes. things like to the knee and the right length and the right, you're still going to, is it too tight? Is it the wrong color? Is it the shoes? Nobody's doing that to men. Do you think that that's something that's ever going to change? Or is that women
okay.
do, you know, opinion?
Yeah, I have a very strong opinion on
okay.
this. And the answer is, it's genetic. This is in your genes. This is male versus female. That's not going to change. And men, when a person walks into the room, if a man sees a woman walk in and a man walk in,
uh-huh.
most men can't tell you what the man even had on. But the man will notice the way the woman is dressed and her appearance. They will notice her because their genetic, it's built into their DNA.
But what about women noticing other women?
And women will do the same thing.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
When women walk into a room, they notice other women. They notice what they have on. When I go out with my wife, she can tell you whether a woman wore that same dress that 5 years ago. And you know, and so women examine other women carefully, and less so for men. That's just the way it is. That's not going to change.
You don't think that we need to get over that, though? Women are kind of hard on each other sometimes. You know what I mean? And men, I think that it puts an extra bit of pressure on women speakers, and you know that maybe I'd like to see change to some extent, but you're saying it probably won't, huh?
Yeah, well, no, I'd like to see change also, and I'd also like to see it, I'd also like to make sure that it never rains on a day when I'm on a golf course. Okay, so it just isn't going
to
change.
Phoenix.
That's exactly right, yeah. But, you know, when you look at someone, you know, if you're a woman, understand that it's just part of being a woman, people are going to notice your appearance. And if you're a man, they're not going to notice it so much. That's just the way it is. So since that's the way it is for women, the answer is use that to your advantage. Dress in a powerful way. Because for a woman, for example, who dresses, if it's in a corporate setting, like a public company, something like that, a woman should be wearing either a pantsuit or an appropriate length dress, not tight, not revealing. And when she comes in, she will be perceived in a more powerful way. If she comes in provocative clothing, that's the only thing that registers on people.
Yeah, it's an interesting difference that I've seen changing a little bit in different generations. You know what I mean? That they don't focus. Like, even when I just go to companies like Apple, where everybody's younger, and the guys are wearing beards on their faces now. And they're,
oh,
you know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah, that you make a really important point there. In some companies, a beard is a sign of importance or status, or it's good to have, like at Apple.
Uh-huh.
Or in the tech industry, having a beard, fine.
Right.
I mean, not only fine, actually positive.
Expected.
It's thought of as
yeah.
attractive, you know, so that's good. If you are in India, I also teach in India.
Uh-huh.
And I teach at the University of India.
Huh.
And in India, I would say that almost all of the leaders have at least a mustache. Some have a full beard.
It is a different look that we're seeing. I think a lot, you know, I came out from a time when it was super formal Mad Men days, you know.
Yes.
And it's so interesting to go to offices and people are wearing Lululemon to work, you know. And
sure, yeah, right. Yep.
And
yeah.
Which I don't miss the business casual, which again was kind of easier for men than women, because they could wear what they used to wear, those kind of docker kind of pants. And we ended up still having to wear dresses, which were just as equally as uncomfortable because they didn't have a female equivalent. So it's kind of interesting to look at how the world has changed. I mean, just looking at your background, obviously you've been in the industries and things that are kind of similar to things I've been in. I mean, I was in banking and sales-related areas since the 80s, and it really has a lot of changes that we've seen throughout those years. And I thought it would be really interesting to focus on the things that we did today, because you've really had an amazing career and you do so many wonderful things, and I really appreciate you being on the show. And I think a lot of people would probably like to know how to follow you in case they want you to come speak or they want to take your course. I want to take that course. That sounded really actually very interesting. I doubt it's online, but if it is, can you just share how people could find you?
You can find me on LinkedIn, and it's my name, Dennis Chookaszian, and you'll be able to find me on LinkedIn. And I do public speaking. I do a number of things over the years. I don't have a direct blog that I write. I do a lot of writing, and I distribute it to controlled distribution lists. But I don't have a blog that I'm publishing. But they can find me on LinkedIn.
Okay. Well, I mean, I know that your information is just really, you've got so much background. Anybody that's looking for board member information, I mean, just looking at what you've come up with is just amazing. And you've worked with so many great groups, with, like I said, the Boy Scouts of America and all the things that you're members of, and director of the Northwestern Memorial Foundation and president of the Foundation for Health Enhancement. I mean, this is really impressive stuff. So I really appreciate you being on the show, Dennis. This was so much fun.
Well, thanks, Diane. I really appreciate it, and I enjoyed talking with you and with your audience.
Oh, I did too. And we will be back right after this message.
Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Jeremy Slate, who's the founder of the Create Your Own Life podcast, which studies the highest performers in the world. He studied literature at Oxford University. He has received so many awards as number one ranking in iTunes for the business category for his podcast. He was one of the top 26 podcasts for entrepreneurs to listen to in 2017 and 18 by CIO Magazine, Inc. All of them are following his work. So I'm really excited, because I think a lot of people are interested in creating their own podcast. So it's so nice to have you here, Jeremy.
Hey, thank you so much for having me today, Dr. Diane. I'm really stoked to hang out with you.
Oh, well, this is going to be fun. And please call me Diane. This will be great, because
it's funny, because so my mother-in-law is a chiropractor, and I just feel like people that like have earned to get that title like deserve it. So I always like to try and give people credit where it's
thank
due.
Thank you. I know. I think it's really respectful. And a lot of people always ask me that, but I'm like, hey, I'll answer to anything, but Diane's fine.
I understand.
Yeah, but you have a very successful podcast. Your website's very appealing for people who really want to know how to do this and read some of to watch and listen to some of your old podcasts. Are just amazing people on your show. And I know I've had a lot of billionaires and fascinating people on my show as well. And a lot of people ask me so many questions. How do you do a podcast? How do you get those kind of people? How do you become so highly rated? So I think that there's a lot of things I want to talk to you about, but I want to get to the point where this is what you've done in your life. So what led up to this? Can you give me your backstory?
Wow. It's like a Beatles song. It's kind of a long and winding road.
Right. That's funny.
So funny enough, I have my undergrad degree in a double major in Catholic theology and Torah. Hmm. And then I actually went and got my master. I studied at New College Oxford in literature, and then I came back and did my master's in early Roman Empire propaganda, not a very like applicable skill in the world of getting a job.
And very specific.
I loved ancient history. I was very interested in how the Roman emperor convinced people he was God. So I kind of, went down a very interesting like path studying that. And then when I came back, it was 2011, and that was kind of a weird job market. And especially like being that I had a master's degree, I was overqualified for a lot of things, but underqualified to actually be a college professor, which is what I wanted to do. So I actually ended up getting a job painting houses during the day, because I worked as a house painter as a teenager, and then managing a gym at night. So I was working about 16, 17 hours a day, busting my butt, just hoping I could find a job at some point in time. And I happened to run into a priest friend of my family. And in New Jersey, I live in New Jersey, and at a private school, you don't need a teaching certificate in order to do that. So, you know, they got me an interview, and I ended up teaching at a private school. And it was rough since I didn't really have any classroom management skills. It was basically, here's 40 kids, here's you, good luck, and I hope you survive. And I wasn't a very happy person pretty early into that journey. And then in 2012, my mom ended up having a really bad stroke. And it made me kind of look at a lot of different things in my life and what I was doing, and, you know, made me decide, like, do I want to keep doing this? And I had made a decision that I was going to find something different, but I wasn't really looking. And it took about a year until my wife was presented with a network marketing opportunity, which I didn't know what that was. So I saw this presentation. I'm like, oh, I'm going to be like a millionaire next week. This is going to be incredible. It didn't work like that. But I then went from there to selling life insurance. I sold products on Amazon and left my Get My Product for a Dollar promo code on my listing and lost all of them in about 20 minutes to one address in Maryland. Someone was much smarter than me. And I actually ended up giving up my entrepreneurial dreams from there. And I taught myself how to build websites from YouTube videos and reading some blog posts. And I worked at a friend's marketing firm. And while I was doing that, I actually started a podcast as a hobby because I'd been a listener since like 2006 and I really enjoyed podcasts. So I started a podcast that took off. We had 10,000 listens in our first 30 days. And that kind of just led us to everything we're doing now.
That's quite a bit of listeners. How'd you do that in 30 days?
A lot of boots on the ground work. And it's funny because I guess I approached it not knowing much about online marketing. I had built a small email list that had about 700 people on it. And I had reached out to some of those people. And I knew the main metric was getting people to subscribe and review the show. So, you know, subscribes are much higher weighted than reviews, but reviews are good for social proof. And they have a little bit of effect in ranking in Apple Podcasts. So I mailed to that list. I texted everyone on my phone, called everyone on my phone, was grabbing friends' phones when we were out, you know, with friends or out at a bar or whatever it may be. I reached out to people on LinkedIn, and that was before I knew what automation was. So I wrote a couple thousand messages by hand, which is a little crazy. And I got about 60-something reviews in my first week doing it. And, you know, we had a good first week listening. And that was when iTunes New and Noteworthy was still open. And then I think it froze for about 2 years after that. But I hit New and Noteworthy. We got promoted for about 8 weeks. And that really helped us with that first month of a great launch.
You know, it's really interesting how to start off a podcast if you have certain things. And I was fortunate having left just interviewing, you know, billionaire like Keith, Ken Fisher and people that I worked with as a professor, that I had connections to some really interesting people to have on my show. And I think a lot of people, when they're starting their podcast, they don't have those kind of connections. They maybe don't have your mailing list. They you know, that you mentioned that you already had, or have your connections, and they want to get this monetized right off the bat. And it's a lot harder than you think to monetize a podcast. Can you want to address what the challenges are with that?
I think too, people have this false idea about it as well. Like they see what Joe Rogan's done. They see like Entrepreneur on Fire. They see a lot of these big shows.
Right.
And I feel like it's anything internet based. People think there's like this thing called magical internet money, and it doesn't really exist. And what actually people need to look at a podcast for is the incredible networking tool it can be, because you can, you know, like you and I are sitting here chatting, and this is the reason we connected, is about a podcast.
Right.
So it's an incredible networking tool. And at the same time, it's a credible branding and positioning tool as well, which has been, you know, pretty awesome that I've been able to, you know, raise my own awareness in my space. And, you know, I didn't start with a business, but I built a business out of that because people started asking me, hey, can you help me with this? But I really recommend to people, like, if you're going to start a podcast, it should promote something else you're doing. Like, it shouldn't be looked at as a monetization vehicle right off the bat.
Right.
It should be promoting something else you're doing, creating opportunities, and also, you know, new business for you.
Well, you know, I had John Lee Dumas on the show and others like him, who, you know, he's from Entrepreneur on Fire that you mentioned. And, you know, it's fun to see what people have done in this space to get noticed. And I think that it is a challenge to recognize what you're doing for. For me, I just want to interview people who I find interesting. And but I see a lot of people who really have a focus on how this can be their next big, you know, paycheck for something or other. And I think you, if you're looking to get to be to the level of the John Lee Dumas and that, you know, it takes years sometimes to just get the kind of following and to do the PR and everything. Now, you talk a lot about basics of PR, and I want to know what kind of PR you think is really helpful for people who have a podcast.
Well, it also kind of depends on, like, where you're at as well, because I think a lot of you have to understand, like, in order to really help yourself, you need to build a media portfolio first as well. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I always teach people is you need to have a media page on your site, and you need to start working with a lot of local media. And I say, like, find whatever your small pond is. Like, for me, it was a small newspaper. It went to every house in the county I live in. I grew up in a small town. It's 5/8 of a mile in size, so nothing really happens there. Mm-hmm. So if I wrote a press release and sent it in, it got printed. So, like, that's really one of the best ways to do it, is start finding out what your small pond is. It may be the small newspaper. It may be, I also live in a lake community that has a magazine that goes around. So you need to find out what that small pond is and start building some media credibility there. Yeah. Start building that on a media page in your site. And the interesting thing about a lot of those is, just since everything's digital now, yes, there's a paper version of those, but a lot of them have online versions too, which also hit Google News. So that's going to be a great way to build a lot of that first press credibility. And then you can start reaching out to some smaller podcasts, some other types of media and things like that. And from there, you kind of just climb the stairs, and you're looking at, like, you know, you start with shows that maybe have less than 20 episodes and less than 20 reviews. And as you're climbing up, you get to maybe shows that have 100 episodes and 50 reviews. And it's stairs, and you continue to build that credibility as you're going up. But honestly, the thing you always want to do is start with press releases to small, you know, local press, because it's actually going to help you to build some credibility, so you're much more acceptable when you reach out for media features.
And when you say press releases, are you talking about newswire type releases where you're spending hundreds of dollars?
No.
Or are you talking about pitches to local?
So what you do, and also, if people don't know how to write a press release, I would recommend Googling HubSpot press release. They have a really good article about it. But what you do is you write a press release, and you go to these small local newspapers or dailies or weeklies or newsletters, or where they may be. You go to their site. Usually you're going to have to scroll down to the bottom, because it's not going to be up on the top, and you're going to look for either newsroom, news tips, editor, something like that. And you're actually going to write that press release to that editor or that newsroom or whoever it may be. And if your pond is small enough, they're probably going to print it right off the bat, if your news story is also newsworthy as well. So that means, is there something interesting about what you're doing? So when I hit 50,000 downloads, it's not a big deal in the world of podcasting, but in the world of media, they don't quite understand that. So it sounds really interesting. So that was newsworthy. Uh-huh. So that was one of my first podcast-related news articles. So that's a really great way to go, because a lot of these small locals are going to print stuff without even editing it and even using the title you create as a press release.
Right, right. And but, you know, you're using podcasts in many ways to do other things. A lot of people do that with their podcasts. You talk about building a $1 million network through podcasting. What kinds of things are you building off of the podcast?
Well, I think first and foremost, it's the connections that you're making off of the podcast. So when I started my show, I made a list of the 100 people I most admired, and I actually reached out to a lot of those people. And the cool thing about that is there may be business opportunities in terms of, like, maybe they have a joint venture they're working on. There may be, you know, something in the future you can do together. Or now I'm 800 episodes in and I've been putting it off for years and I'm finally writing a book. And I'm going to write about a lot of the people that I've interviewed and spoken to on the show, and also ask their help in launching it and getting it out there and helping it get to a bestseller status. So you want to kind of see how a lot of these people that you're talking to can not only enhance your own credibility, meaning the more people that you speak to that are credible, the more credible you look. But at the same time, like, how can you do business opportunities with them, and how can you use it for something long term? It doesn't have to be writing a book, but you also want to have some future vision on it, with where is this going and what might we do together?
Yeah, you know, you bring up a lot of things that Dr. Gilda Carl and I talk about on our your Media Docs videos that we create, because we talk about how you get people to follow, the show. Not only that, but just how you get people on the show who you'd like to talk to, who are interesting, and the interactions you have. There's a lot of that goes on behind podcasting that people don't recognize. that takes a lot of time. I think a lot of people think they're just going to put a microphone in front of them and it's going to be really easy and it's just going to show up in the air somewhere, right?
Right.
You want to speak a little bit to the challenge of what it takes to do it? I mean, what aspects? I don't know how much of it you do yourself or that you hire other people to do, but there's a lot of different aspects to it that people don't even consider.
Well, in the beginning, I did it all myself. Mm-hmm. And then eventually you figure out what works and, you know, you start having some revenue and stuff like that and you can start outsourcing. Because in my humble opinion, I don't think you should be putting money towards things that aren't yet yielding money. So I did a lot of the efforts myself in the beginning. Mm-hmm. And that includes like the original design work for the show. Like you need some decent graphics so that you can kind of get that past that first barrier of entry if people want to even check out your show. Mm-hmm. You have to do show editing. So I had to learn how to use Adobe Audition and Adobe Premiere. You know, I had to learn about good microphones. I started out with a cheaper one, which is an Audio Technica, which is like under $100. Now I have a Shure SM7B, which is like a studio quality microphone, but I didn't start there. Like I've gotten up to higher quality stuff, but you have to do a lot of stuff, even scheduling of guests.
Right.
One of the things that I do that a lot of people don't even consider, and I'm sure you do, Diane, is I have a running spreadsheet of a content calendar. Like, you know, what are the things that I'm going to have coming out, you know, the 3 days next week and the week after that. So like I'm putting the future there. I do think a lot of podcasters are just thinking about, okay, I need 2 episodes for next week. Like they're not thinking in the future and you have to put that there if you're running it as a professional.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of different things you have to consider in terms of doing that. And editing like is not quick and easy a lot of times unless you're just going straight from conversation, you know, to tape, which if there's outtakes, it's going to be something you got to handle. So there's definitely a lot of work and episodes can take hours to put together, you know, if you're not really systemizing them, figuring out how to outsource them once you can, you know, find a revenue source.
You know, I like to use templated shells. As you know, I use GarageBand an awful lot, you know, if I'm not using Camtasia or some other form to edit things. And I think, you know, I like real shows. Like I don't cut out a lot of stuff. I had one guy get stopped by the police while we were chatting. I cut that out. But if a dog barks or if you're on mute for a second or whatever it is, it's not that big a deal to me. I like a real show. But, you know, some people, they want it like perfect, like absolutely perfect. Do you think that makes a big difference?
Well, it's to a point, right? Like I had a guest on once that it was a great interview, but he said, like, you know, 86 times. And it made it really hard to listen to. Like, I actually counted because I was curious. And it made it really hard to listen to. So you have to look at when does things we may cut, you know, hurt the listenability of it, and when is that really, really important? And also at the same time, like, I just interviewed a former baseball player the other day. And when I asked the question, I got tongue-tied, and it came out really weird, and he started laughing. Like, that's not something I wanted to have in the final cut.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to look at, like, when does it fit and when does it not fit? Because sometimes it's fine for the conversation flow and it's not really a big deal. So it's kind of learning like what works where and you know, what needs to go.
You know, when I do my shows, when you're talking about that, it reminds me of what makes me tongue-tied and what I like to do and what I don't like to do. You know, with what I notice for me, the hardest part for me is after the show, I do the editing of putting it together into one show. Say if two people are on the same show, I combine them, and at the beginning, I might do an intro later and say who's going to be on the show that day. That is when there's nobody on the other end and I have to just talk off the top of my head to myself like that. That's the hardest part for me. Is that hard for you, or what's the hardest part for you?
It was weird at first, but I feel like at some point you get used to it.
I don't know. Years later, I still hate it. A thousand people
later.
Well,
one of the things that I do as well is I do the same thing you do where I record an intro after and I kind of talk about what we discussed and everything. Mm-hmm. So I do take some notes on like what I'm going to talk about.
Right.
And I do have a pretty consistent way that I talk about it. Like we've had the same sponsor for a really long time, which has been Audible. So I talk about, you know, the book I'm recommending.
Mm-hmm.
I talk about who the guest is. I talk about the 3 to 5 things you're going to learn from them. And I don't know. It's just, I feel like eventually you get past that uncomfortableness of it and just understand that like it does help the show flow and it does really. Because I feel like for the listener, they just get dumped into a conversation and they don't have those little things that it may not grab their interest as much. They don't know what to stick around for. So you got to understand the bigger purpose and why you're putting it in there.
How did you get Audible as your sponsor? I'm curious. A lot of people ask me how you get sponsors.
So there's a couple different ways we've done it. They've done some paid spots with me off and on over the years, which has been great. But I've actually found that we've made more money by actually using their affiliate program for podcasters. Because you get paid per free membership you give away for Audible, which is great. You make like $15 for free, per free membership you give away. And we give away a lot of memberships. I'm always telling people what book I'm currently reading, and that, you know, the kind people at Audible are going to let them go grab one if they're willing to go over and, you know, check it out.
Yeah.
So we've done some paid spots for them with a typical CPM, but I've actually found that giving away the book I'm currently reading in audio version has been a much better and more lucrative way to do it.
You know, I do my own affiliate programs from my curiosity research and all the things that I do. And I think affiliate programs are really effective. And I think a lot of people have affiliate pages and different things on their sites. But I think when you're doing a podcast, when you share that this is how, you know, you can get this, I really think that's a great way to do it. And you've looked a lot about how to grow your business, and that's why you've done so well. And so I noticed you talk a little bit about the future in media and how to become your own media company, and I just want to touch on that a little bit, because I think a lot of people want to know how to have their own media company.
Well, I think that it's kind of like you see a lot of the content being created now, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's more story driven. It's more about like the companies have a voice. Like I know even Trader Joe's has a podcast now, and I love Trader Joe's. So
everybody's got a podcast now.
So it's giving you an opportunity to really have a conversation with people and not be a nameless, faceless company anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So the media you're creating is now a relationship building tool. And because of the way media is being consumed, especially video, like there's a lot more video being consumed right now, which has been driving me to even start to do a little bit more. Like it is definitely a harder media to deliver on, but companies need to be able to create a lot of that stuff in order to start connecting with people, in order to start making more of a relationship, because brands are finding it harder to compete because they don't build relationships with people anymore. They're just big nameless, faceless companies. And I think since we've been driven more towards personal brands and more towards, you know, people feeling like they can connect with people online, companies have to create great media, whether it's a podcast or whether it's a YouTube show or whether it's the small clips and posts they create for social media. If you want to survive and grow, like you have to be creating those pieces now, and you have to be realizing like, what does your audience want? Is it meal tips? Is it more education around your products and services? Is it something that's going to help them in their personal life? So when they think of you, they think of those wins they've had in their personal life, and that's why they want to do business with you. So you need to be thinking about and considering a lot of these things and going more long-term with them. I think a lot of companies look at it and they're like, okay, month one, this didn't make us any money. Month two, it didn't make us any money. We're going to cut the program. But mm-hmm. you need to realize that's the direction where media is going. And in order to make it work, it's more of a long tail thing.
Yeah, it really is. And I think there's a lot of promotion that's involved in making sure that podcasts are successful. And I know when this show comes out, everybody's going to see it on Facebook. They're going to see it on LinkedIn and all the different sites. How do you promote your podcasts with the different social media sites?
So, well, the first thing is understanding like what the native content is for each platform. Mm-hmm. And that means like the content that does well on that platform.
Right.
So Facebook likes a lot of videos and photos.
Right.
Instagram really just loves photos. I haven't seen my videos do as well anymore.
Mm-hmm.
LinkedIn for a long time loved video. Now they like long form written content again, which was popular a couple of years ago. So for me, I'm writing long form written content that tells a story. And you have to realize that first three lines on LinkedIn is your place you're going to hook somebody and get them to read the rest of the post before that see more button. So I tend to tell a story about the episode or about something I learned in my life and realize that I only have 1,300 characters to do it. And you're skipping lines in between because you want to make it mobile friendly because most people are reading on their phone. So for me, like our biggest, most active network, though it's not the network I have the biggest following on, is LinkedIn.
Yeah.
We get a lot of engagement over there. We get a lot of views over there, a lot of likes and comments, and a lot of that drives back to the show. So we're focusing on telling stories in long form written content, but making sure we keep it to 1,300 characters because that's where they cut you off. And making sure we have the right hashtag with that as well, because the thing I've been finding, and I'm sure you've seen this too, is now with the way hashtags are going, LinkedIn tells different brands and individuals that are in different areas, like, hey, this post has hashtag blah, blah, blah on it. You should go comment on it. And because of that, we're actually getting conversations with brands that may not have been aware of our content before as well. So for me, the biggest opportunity out there right now is LinkedIn.
What are your most popular hashtags for what you talk about on your show?
Greatness is a good one. Extraordinary is a good one. Just a simple one, a podcast interview, honestly, because a lot of people don't think of it, but there's a lot of traffic to it, is a really good one as well.
Hmm.
And then I also have one for the show, which is just create your own life, because the thing you want to think of
mm-hmm.
is if people search that hashtag, they can then find all your content.
Right.
So that's also important to do as well, because it's kind of making an aggregator for yourself.
Right, right. And you can do that on Twitter and the other sites as well. And I think that's really important. I use Dr. Diane Radio on mine for different reasons. And I think sometimes I'll use Curiosity Code if it's a curiosity-based thing. And I think it's great to have one that you own that does, you know, showcase you. And
right.
You've brought up some really great points. And I'm curious, you've interviewed so many interesting people. Is there any particular interview that stands out, or a few people you've interviewed that you just go, wow, that was just incredible?
Oh gosh, there's so many. I don't know if we have enough time there. So a couple months ago, I interviewed Jonathan Goldsmith, who you may know is the most interesting man in the world. He did all those commercials and all those memes are about him. And people looked at him and they said, oh, Jonathan, you were successful so late in life, because he started out as a cowboy actor and then he left Hollywood and then came back and did these commercials. And he goes, well, actually, I made a whole bunch of money in network marketing. I became a multimillionaire over there, and people don't know about that. So I think, to me, it made me look at that, and it's like, well, people have different definitions of success, and just because we see a certain thing doesn't mean there's not success there. Like, that's a big deal as well.
Yeah.
And then I think about 2 weeks ago, I just got to interview former CIA director and four-star General David Petraeus.
Huh.
Which that was just very, very cool to get to talk to somebody at that level
mm-hmm.
and kind of learn, like, how did he find mentorship? How did he operate day to day? Like, how did he deal with other people? And it's just very, very interesting to see what people at that level operate like.
You know, they're all really interesting. I learned something from every show, and I'm doing three of them, 3 hours of interviews, you know, that air a week, which is quite a bit after 3.5 years of doing this. That's a lot of people.
Hopefully you're not doing them in one day, because God bless you.
That's a lot of people. And I think, you know, what you learn something from every interview. And I think it's really great that there's people out there who have done it, who want to share the value of what they've gotten from it. And I really was looking forward to having you on, because I know you've done so well with yours. And I think a lot of people want to follow you and learn more from you. So I was wondering if you had a link to share or something you'd like for people to know.
Yeah. So if they are interested in learning about the podcast, that's over at jeremyryanslate.com. Or if they really were interested in our conversation about media today and they want to figure out how they can start getting on the right podcast, and maybe they've even failed at that. I don't want them to make all the mistakes that I had and take as long as I did to figure it out. So I put together an awesome piece for them called The 7 Reasons You're Not Getting Featured on Your Favorite Podcast. And they can actually grab that over at commandyourbrand.com/7reasons. And the number 7 or the word 7 will work for that.
That's awesome. This was so much fun, and I really enjoyed our conversation. Thank you for being on the show, Jeremy.
Hey, Diane, thank you so much for having me. This was awesome.
Oh, you're welcome, and we'll be back right after this message. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank both Dennis and Jeremy for being my guests today. We get so many great guests on the show. If you've missed any past episodes, you can catch them at drdianehamilton.com. If you go to the blog, you can actually read them and listen to them. But there's a lot of information on the site in addition to the radio show. You can find out more about cracking the Curiosity Code and the Curiosity Code Index, as well as the Power of Perception and the Perception Power Index. Everything in terms of speaking and writing and everything that I do is on the site. So I hope you take some time to check it out. And I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.